Evening, Berkner High School students. I'm Jordan Galvan, and this is Tree Fam. I'm president, and he's vice president of World Affairs Council. Thank you for joining us today. Out of respect for our speaker, Dr. McClelland, I have a few quick housekeeping items. First, we would like to thank the BHS film students for recording our event today, Mr. Mitchell for helping us get the auditorium all set up as well. Let's make sure all the cell phones are turned off and put away, as well as any earphones. Please remember there's no eating or drinking in the auditorium, as well as we should keep quiet so that way we can hear what the speaker has to say. At the end, Dr. McClelland will be able to take a few questions, so please hold all questions until then. I have the great honor of introducing Dr. McClelland. He is a 1954 graduate of the University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston. Following his internship at the University of Kansas Medical Center and 2 years of military service in the Air Force in Germany, he completed his residency in general surgery at Parkland Memorial Hospital. He then completed 1 year fellowship in splenic hemodynamics with Dr. F. Bashur in the Department of Internal Medicine and UT Southwestern. He was appointed to the facility of the UT Southwestern Medical Center in 1962 and is the first faculty member to hold the Alvin Baldwin Jr. Chair in Surgery, an endowment designated for support of surgical education. His primary interests were in gastrointestinal surgery and postgraduate medical education. As originator and editor of the Audio Journal Review, General Surgery and Selected Readings in General Surgery, his influence as a medical educator extends beyond the department into surgical training programs throughout the country. Please help me welcome Dr. Robert McClelland.
Thank you. Let me know if my voice is not projecting to the back. Does it sound okay to you? Okay. All right. Well, I've got a lot to talk about, but I'm going to try to capsule it as much as I can. First thing I want to do is tell you what happened and what I was associated with at Parkland Hospital on November the 22nd, 1963, when President Kennedy was brought in from having been shot in his motorcade downtown. And where I was at the time was in the operating room, two floors above the emergency room, showing a film to some of the surgery residents about how to repair a hiatus hernia. When I heard a little tap on the door where I was showing that, and I shut off the projector and went to the door and looked out, and one of the senior surgery residents was standing there and said, "Dr. Mack, would you step out for a minute? I need to tell you something." And I said, "Sure." So I did. I shut off the projector and stepped out. And he said, "They just called from the emergency room and said that President Kennedy," we knew he was coming to town that day, "that President Kennedy had just been shot during his motorcade. And they're bringing him to Parkland right now. And they want all of the surgery faculty to come to the emergency room immediately." So with nothing more said, we got on the elevator there in the emergency room, rode two floors down in the operating room, and rode two floors down to the emergency room. And as the elevator doors opened up, I came out into an area that was about 50 feet on each side that was sort of called a pit in the emergency room, around which were a lot of patient booths for examining patients. Well, usually that pit area was completely empty, but today, on this day, it was jammed with men in business suits, shoulder to shoulder. And I thought to myself, I've never seen anything like this. And as I stood there, that crowd of men sort of spontaneously parted so that I could look down to a hallway that came off of the emergency room to four trauma rooms for treating trauma patients just next to the emergency room. And there, sitting on a folding chair outside of the trauma room one, was Mrs. Kennedy sitting there in her bloody clothing. So it became apparent right away that all what they had said this was true. And I had to practically, make myself keep walking back toward her and going into trauma room one. And as I pushed the door open, I immediately saw President Kennedy lying on a cart on his back with a light shining into his face, and his bloody head was visible very clearly. And I was gratified, and at the same time I was horrified. I was gratified to see I was not by myself. I initially thought maybe I was going to be the first person there. But Dr. Perry, one of the other faculty surgeons, and Dr. Baxter, another faculty surgeon, had just come into the room before I did. And so as I walked in and walked by the cart that the president was lying on, Dr. Perry reached across the president and handed me a surgical retractor. And he said, "Bob, would you go ahead and stand at the head of the cart and hold this retractor, because we're going to make an incision in his neck and look at the wound in his neck, because he had a wound in his neck as well as in his hand, and do a tracheostomy. And you stand there and hold the retractor while Charlie and I do that." So I did that. I stood at the position that he had me stand in. And when I got to the head of the cart, I could distinctly and unfortunately see how terrible the wound was. And I said to Dr. Perry and Dr. Baxter, I said, "My God, have you seen the back of his head?" And they said, "No, we just came in here before you did." And I said, "Well, on the right side, it's basically gone. He had a huge wound back here where I'm pointing that was probably 5 to 6 inches in diameter." And as I stood there, a portion of his cerebellum actually fell out onto the cart. So it was obvious that this was a fatal wound. There's no way that he could have survived this. Nevertheless, they continued with the tracheostomy. But just as they got into the midst of that, Dr. Clark, who was our neurosurgeon on the faculty, had come into trauma room one and was standing next to the cart where Dr. Baxter and Dr. Perry and I were standing and watching what we were doing. And Dr. Clark was watching the cardiac monitor. And after about 3 minutes after he got into the room, all of a sudden the cardiac monitor straight lined. And so Dr. Clark said to Dr. Perry, he said, "Mac, you can stop now because he's gone." And with that, everybody kind of stood back and were, you know, just crushed by what had happened. But we stood there, and after a few minutes, a priest came in, Father Huber, who had been called, and he came in, and the president's face had been covered with a sheet, and Father Huber uncovered his face and administered the last rites to him. I couldn't hear all that he said, but I was standing about 2 feet away from him, and I heard him say the first words, "If thou livest," and then I couldn't hear the next things that he said, but he performed the absolution. And as soon as he got through with that, Mrs. Kennedy came into the room. She had been sitting outside on a chair. And I couldn't hear her because her voice was so low and quiet that it was not possible for me to understand her, even though I was just 2 or 3 feet away from her. But clearly from what Father Huber said, he had been asked if the president had received last rites. And Father Huber said, "Yes, I've given him conditional absolution," emphasizing the word conditional. Mrs. Kennedy grimaced a bit when she heard the word conditional, but she didn't say anything to Father Huber about that. And she stood there for a moment, and then she walked down slowly to the end of the cart, where the president was lying covered with a sheet now, and his bare right foot was out, sticking out from beneath the sheet. And as she walked by his bare right foot, Mrs. Kennedy leaned over and kissed his foot and then walked out of the room. That was the last that we saw of her at that time. And so with that, all of us left the room and went back upstairs to the operating room. And that was what happened with President Kennedy on that day, that we were unfortunately not able to do anything for him because of the gravity of his wound. Then the next day, nothing happened. And on Sunday, I came home from church with my wife and 2 children. And so while they were upstairs getting ready to go out to dinner, I thought, well, I'll turn on the TV and see what's happening. But just as I turned the television on, I could hear a voiceover saying, he's been shot, he's been shot. And I thought, my goodness, what now? And the picture formed with that, and Ruby has just shot Oswald, whom was identified as the shooter who killed the president. And when I saw that, I got up out of my chair in my living room, walked to the foot of the stairway, and called over my wife. I said, I'm going to have to miss lunch. I have to go to Parker. And she said, why? And I said, well, they just shot Oswald. And she said, who is Oswald? And I said, he's the man they say shot President Kennedy. Oh, she said, well, we'll see you later. And so I got in my car and sped out to Parker, met my chief of surgery, Dr. Shires, coming the other way, and we stopped and told each other what we had just found out. He turned his car around and we went back out to Parker. And parked behind the emergency room, which you could do at that time, and ran into the emergency room and saw that what was happening, that they were now working on Oswald, who had been shot by Ruby. And so I had to help operate on Oswald. He was still alive, but he unfortunately had an extremely serious injury. The bullet had entered his side from the left and gone across the back of his abdomen and injured both his vena cava and his aorta. Very grave injuries that are rarely survivable. But nevertheless, Dr. Shires, who's the chief surgeon, and Dr. Perry and Dr. Baxter and I were helping him, was able to get a clamp to the injury and about ready to be able to repair it. And then, unfortunately, Oswald had a cardiac arrest after that. Well, as soon as that occurred, Dr. Perry and I walked out of surgery and opened his chest and massaged Oswald's heart for some time, probably 20 to 25 minutes, because initially it looked like his heart was going to come back. But then it got bloodier and bloodier until finally Dr. Clark, the neurosurgeon who had come in, was standing behind us, was looking at the cardiac monitor, said to Dr. Perry, he said, Mac, you all can stop now because he's gone. And so with that, the president was declared dead. And so we all immediately then stood away from the president, the room that he was in, and become crowded with people there in the emergency room. And everybody emptied out of the room. And in fact, it was so crowded that Dr. Baxter and I were unable to get out until the rest of the crowd left. And so we just stood back until the crowd left, and then we started to leave. But before we could leave, the door came open to try to room where the president was again. And a priest came in, Father Huber, we later found his name to be. And he came over, and so we just had to stand there because we would almost have to push him out of the way to get out of the room. So we just simply stood there. And Father Huber came over to the president, uncovered his face, and anointed his forehead, and bent over to him, and all I could hear him say were the first words. And he said, if thou livest. And then he completed the last rites and was getting ready to leave himself when the room to trauma room, door to trauma room one came open again. And Mrs. Kennedy came in. She'd been sitting on a chair outside the trauma room one all this time. And she stood across from Dr. Baxter and I and looked down at the president. And she exchanged the ring from her finger to the president's finger, and a ring from his finger to her finger. I can't give you any more detailed description of that. And then she stood there for a moment and walked down to the end of the cart the president was lying on. And before she left the room, his bare foot was sticking out from underneath the sheet. And she leaned over and kissed his bare foot and then walked out of the room. And that's the last we saw Mrs. Kennedy on that day. But that was a very difficult thing to get through at that time, as you might imagine. So that's what happened with President Kennedy as far as what we saw in Parkland on that day after he was shot. The next day, nothing happened. And then on Sunday, my wife and two children and I had been to church, and we came back. And while they were upstairs getting ready to go out for lunch, I thought, well, I'll turn the television on and see what's happening now. And as I did, before the picture formed, I heard the words, "He's been shot, he's been shot." And I thought, my goodness, what now? Well, just for that, the picture formed, and I could see what had happened. Ruby had just shot Oswald. So I called up to my wife, and I said, well, I'm going to have to miss lunch. I have to go to Parkland. And she said, why? And I said, well, they just shot Oswald. And so she said, who is Oswald? Well, he's the man that they say shot President Kennedy. And she replied, well, we'll see you later. So I went out to Parkland very quickly and was joined in his auto right behind me by my chief of surgery, Dr. Charles. And we both parked behind the emergency room, ran into trauma room one, where they were attending to Oswald, who had just shot the president. Unfortunately, he had been shot in such a way that he no longer had a blood pressure, and had had a cardiac arrest, but they got his heart going again, and we were able to get him up to the operating room, now 2 days after the president had been shot, and operate on him. And Dr. Perry and Dr. Shires and I were able to actually get down to where the injury was of Oswald. And unfortunately, he also had an injury at the main cava and the aorta. And he arrested. And we stopped what we were doing at surgery, dropped out Dr. Perry and I. And Dr. Perry opened Oswald's chest, and we massaged his heart for several minutes. And it looked initially like his heart was going to start beating again. But then it became very placid, and it was clear that he was not going to recover. So he was declared dead, and we left the room where we had been attending to Oswald, and went out and talked to the Secret Service man who had been with him when he was shot. And he said, when he was shot, he got down over his face, over Oswald's face, and said, son, you're hurt real bad. Would you like to say anything to me now? And he said, Oswald, who had his eyes shut, opened his eyes, looked up at him for a long few seconds, and then closed his eyes and shook his head from side to side. Anyway, the Secret Service man said, I will believe until the day I die that he was thinking about whether he was going to say something critical to me, but then made the decision not to do that. So that's what happened there at Parkland to the president and to the man who shot him, Oswald. The next thing that happened, of course, person who had shot Oswald was Jack Ruby, and of course he was immediately imprisoned, and we did not have to do anything to him, of course, because he did not have any injury. But anyway, it was obvious that he had shot the president, and shot Oswald, rather. And so that's what happened at Parkland on those days. After that, I think I will probably just leave time for you to ask some questions if you'd like to ask any questions.
many different movies and whatnot, and they heard or studied different conspiracy theories. Is there any chance you'd be willing to share with us about what you thought about the bullets and the entrance exit wounds, etc.?
Sure. Well, it looked to us as if, and we later confirmed this when we saw the Zapruder film on the shooting of the president, I mean of Oswald, that the bullet entered Oswald's side and went across the back of his abdomen and injured his vena cava and his aorta. So this is, as I said, this is essentially an irreparable injury. And that's what happened with him. So.
Are there any other students who wish to ask a question? Okay, you can come. You guys can come line up right here and wait your turn to ask a question.
Hi, Dr. McClelland. My name is Soraya Hay. I'm one of the students who attend Berkner High School. Now, I know losing a patient, whether it's the bad guy or the good guy, is never easy. And I want to know how that toll took on your family emotionally.
How what?
How, like, your emotional state was after losing JFK.
I'm still not sure I understand what you're asking.
Like, did it, were you traumatized after losing the president?
Oh, yes. Everybody always asked me, how has that changed my life or anything? And certainly it was the most terrible event I was ever involved with. But I can't say I altered my life or changed anything about it. That's what I did every day, is take care of injuries like that. Of course, I didn't do it for a person, but that was something that I was trained to do and did. And while it was quite shocking, it didn't really, you know, change my life or anything like that.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Faith. I was wondering, when you first heard that the president had been shot, like when you were doing the film with the students, how did you initially react to that when you heard that like, the president was shot? How did you react to that?
Oh, that was very shocking, of course. I was showing them in the operating room in Parkland. I was showing a film about how to repair a hiatus hernia to some of the senior surgery residents. And I heard them knock on the door. And so I went to the door, and one of the other residents was standing there. And he said, Dr. Mack, would you come out? I need to tell you something. So I went in and showed off the projector and stepped out. And he said, they just called from the emergency room and said that President Kennedy was shot downtown. And they're bringing him right now into the emergency room. They want all the surgical faculty to come right away to the emergency room. So with that, we got on the elevator, went down two floors from the operating room to the emergency room. And while we were going down, I said to the resident who had come to get me, I said, well, hopefully this is not as bad as it sounds. But we often get some horrible stories told to us that are being brought into the emergency room, and it turns out it's not that bad. Well, with that, the door of the elevator came open, and we went out into a large area next to the elevator called the pit that was about 50 feet on each side, surrounded by patient examination booths. And that area, which usually was empty, was jammed with men in business suits, which is something I've never seen. And then just as I took that in, that crowd of men parted, made a little spontaneous corridor down through and to the trauma rooms off of the emergency room, four trauma rooms off the emergency room. And there sitting on a chair outside trauma room one was Mrs. Kennedy in her bloody clothing. So I thought, well, this is just what they said it was. And I went on down, walked past her, walked into the room, and saw President Kennedy lying on his back with an operating room light shining on his bloody head. And that was, you know, what we saw initially there.
Hello, sir. I have a question. I know that you may not be legally allowed to say how much of the damage that was to the president's body, but I heard from online, I've done research about it, that the bullet that entered his head might have not been the actual bullet to kill him, but that someone else that was actually protecting him had shot him on accident. And I was just wondering if you could confirm or say whether there were any more bullet holes in the two shot by Oswald?
No, I think all of us have a very muddled image of what happened exactly. In fact, even though I was right there on the spot, I didn't really have much of an idea of how he was wounded in the head until a good many years later I saw the Zapruder film that was taken by Mr. Zapruder of the assassination. And it became apparent to me when I saw that film that he was shot from the back and from the front, that he was initially shot in the back from maybe one of the buildings behind, and his hands went up to his neck because there was a wound in his neck about where I'm pointing, that one of the places where we made an incision to put a tracheostomy into him. And then the second shot that hit him, though, was fired from the grassy knoll in front of the motorcade, and that is a shot that killed him. Hit him in the front, probably near the hairline on the right side, and blew out the back of his head and killed him. That was the second shot. But that came from in front and from behind the picket fence on the grassy knoll.
Thank you, sir. It's been a pleasure to be here.
Hi, my name is Ashley Johnson. We know that since you had all these ideas and emotions going through your head, how did you know what to do when you first saw President Kennedy?
How did we know what to do?
How to perform on him when all of this was going on?
Well, that's a good question, because that's obviously a very exciting and traumatic event. Well, fortunately, of course, what I was trained and my associates were trained to do is to take care of gunshot wounds all the time. So I'm not discounting that, we do that all the time, it didn't mean anything to us. But we never did it on the president. And so obviously this put that in quite a different light. Nevertheless, you don't think at that time, you just act. And you go into an active mode and start doing the treatment that you've been trained to do in situations like this. Then afterwards, in fact, what we did after the president was declared dead, all of us who were involved in that went back upstairs to the operating room and sat down and sort of looked at one another as if, was that what really happened, or were we really there? And began to, assess what we thought at that time. But during the actual event, all you're doing is reacting.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, my name is Sarah. I heard that if y'all would have just left the bullet and stopped the bleeding, he would have survived or something. And I wanted to hear your thoughts about that.
No, he had no chance of surviving the wound that he had. That has been considered, and brought up many times. But the way this bullet hit him, and I think that the bullet that killed him was fired from the front and hit him in the right side of the head and blew out a large hole, probably 5 inches in diameter, in the back half of his brain. So there was no way that could be survived. And he was still making attempts to breathe despite that when he was brought into the emergency room. And so, when you start working on him, and people ask sometimes, why are you doing a tracheostomy on him? Well, it wasn't just to do a tracheostomy, it was also, he had a wound here in his neck. And so Dr. Perry and Dr. Baxter, who were doing that procedure, wanted to see what had been injured in his neck. And of course, by the time they got to that area, he'd been declared dead. So.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much for your time and your valuable contribution. On our behalf of Berkner Welfare Council and Berkner High School, we'd love to give you a pen from the STEM Academy and a BY pen for your jacket.
Thank you.
With a framed picture associated with students' signatures.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you guys. All right, we're going to start releasing classes so you can gather your things. The bell's about to ring so you can go ahead and head to sixth period. Let's start off with the
first, please drop the things and start heading out.